been here with us before, you know I don't need this microphone for this room, but it does matter for anybody who's watching the video feed this morning, whether that's in the nursery or people out sick, things of that nature. So it is important, believe it or not. Let's get into the Word together. We're going to be in Galatians 6. Believe it or not, we are only 2 weeks away from finishing Galatians. We've been in Galatians for really almost exactly a year now. So my family showed up September 1st. I think there was a couple weeks in September where we looked at some other stuff. But if I remember right, we started Galatians in the middle of September last year. So we haven't, of course, been doing Galatians every week, as you know. But we have spent the better part of the last year in this book. And it's been encouraging to hear what the Lord has been doing through this book in all of our lives, both in mine, from being able to study and benefit from the study of it, and also you, as you've been able to sit under the preaching of this book. It's amazing how God has designed his church to work that way, to be a church that grows and flourishes under the Word together. And we're going to be looking at some of the aspects of that even this morning. So let's look together at Galatians, and we will be in chapter 6, verses 6 to 10 this morning. Galatians 6, verses 6 to 10. Let's read this together. This is the Word of the Lord. Let the one who is taught the Word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption, but the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Let's pray. Father, as we come before you once again to receive instruction from your holy word, we ask humbly once again that you would illumine our weak and fragile minds to understand what you're saying to us. God, we pray that this morning our hearts would be soft, fertile ground that's ready to receive your word. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would move through the proclamation of your gospel and powerfully this morning. Strengthen us, Lord. Build us up as your church this morning, that we would become all that you have made us as your people to be, to image you rightly, to glorify you in this world, to cultivate and take dominion of the garden that you have placed us in, that you would be glorified. We pray that that would be accomplished by your power, not through ours. We pray in Jesus' name. Just a few days ago, our daughter, one of our daughters, asked my wife, "Mommy, why are we the only people in our neighborhood who don't grow our own food?" I'm assuming offended by it. We do live in one of those neighborhoods where everybody seems to have an abundant garden going on. One day we hope to have an abundant garden going on, but we're not there yet. But our girls have become particularly interested in the idea of farming and homesteading as of late, because they've been listening to the audiobook of The Little House on the Prairie. Maybe you're aware of that story in that series. If you're not aware of what I'm talking about, the story is about a family who lived in the United States in the 1870s up in Wisconsin. And as soon as they decided that Wisconsin was getting too crowded in the big woods, so to speak, they moved down to somewhere in Nebraska, moved out west to try to claim some land for themselves where they could have a prairie and begin to farm it and cultivate it away from a heavy population of people. But the story does transfix our minds in a way to be interested in this idea of homesteading and farming and making something of the land that's around us. It captures all of the ups and downs of that kind of life. And it also depicts the reality that farming can be very difficult, that it can be fraught with frustration and setbacks. But in farming, typically, hard work pays off in the end for those who are willing to be diligent and get the job done. So it shouldn't surprise us that the Bible is packed full of analogies and metaphors comparing spiritual truths to the labor of farming. Jesus uses these kind of illustrations all throughout his ministry. In fact, this is a bit of a side note, but if you didn't know, there's one historian who has noted that, his name's Richard Bauckham, has noted that Jesus more than likely was actually a farmer. That his family was more than likely actually farmers. In Nazareth, where they lived, it was a farming community, and it would have been common for each family to be distributed a plot of land which they would farm in order to have sustenance for the family. And if he was referenced as a carpenter, his father Joseph the carpenter, that most likely was because it was just some sort of side hustle that his father did, which distinguished him from the rest of the families in the community. So Jesus himself more than likely grew up farming. And so he used these sorts of analogies all the time because they apply so well to spiritual truths that people needed to know. And they also were very helpful for people because the entire Greco-Roman world was, by and large, a farming community. People lived this sort of life. They understood these sort of truths. And Paul grew up, of course, in that same world where the nature of farming would have been known to be useful in making connections to how the kingdom of God works because everyone in that community understood what the life of a farmer looks like. And of course, this morning we have, at the center of our text, a farming metaphor. It is a metaphor that you've probably heard before. You reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. And this is a principle that's been planted into the world as a way that God has designed things to work to such an extent that many faith groups have explained this same principle in different ways. Some people might call it karma. Some people might call it, you get what's coming to you. You know, we hear these little phrases, and throughout the Proverbs, where we get general wisdom, we see these ideas even there, that you reap what you sow. What you invest in is what you will get a return on. This idea is replete within the Bible. This morning, we're going to see the vitally important call within the Christian life to sow well. To sow well. And first, we're going to see the call to sow the word. Secondly, we're going to see the call to sow within. And then lastly, we're going to see the call to sow without. Without just means outside of yourself. I said within, so I forgot to say without too. But if you didn't know, that's what that means. To sow the word, sow within, and sow without. So first, let's look at the call to sow the word. Look at Galatians 6, verse 6. It says, "Let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches." And in this verse, Paul teaches a principle that God intends to serve as a blessing and as a guard to the church. And that principle is that Christians should joyfully support those who teach the word of God. What Paul's doing in this text is he's placing a burden on the one who is taught the word to share all good things, you see that phrase there, good things with the one who teaches the word. Now, good things there certainly can include more than financial provision, but Paul has central in his mind the material provision that teachers might need to live their lives as a teacher in the vocation under the support of those who are being taught. This was a common teaching in Paul's writings. It's not just found here. In fact, it's also a teaching from Jesus as well. You may remember in Luke 10, Jesus calls 72 disciples to go out and preach the kingdom of God to the community around them. And he tells them that when they come to a house
that's willing to provide support for their ministry, that they should stay there. And the reason they should stay there is, he says it in Luke 10, verse 7, because the laborer deserves his wages. And Paul says, again, quite clearly, in 1 Corinthians 9:14, the Lord commanded that those who proclaim the gospel should get their living by the gospel. And then again he says in 1 Timothy 5:17 and 18, let the elders, of course that's just the pastors of the church, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in the preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle the ox when he treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. Now that word in 1 Timothy, double honor, means that those who preach and teach the word should be compensated as if this is a highly honored vocation. This is the meaning that Paul has in mind here in Galatians. Now this verse may seem to be a little bit out there and random within the context of Galatians, but just think about how this actually fits right within the context of what Paul is saying in Galatians. The big issue in these Galatian churches is that false teachers are coming in and are perverting the truth. They're trying to get the Galatian churches to embrace a false gospel. So Paul knows that the right way to deal with a false gospel is with a clear proclamation of the true gospel. You want to deal with the problem of people perverting the truth, then have people who know the truth and know how to proclaim it rightly and correct what is being preached wrongly. But notice what Paul says is being taught. And this is what I want you to see as the central point in what the church ought to be sown here. Notice what he says is being taught in verse 6 of Galatians 6. It's the word. The word is being taught. The word, which is Paul's shorthand way of referring to the truth of the gospel. So men who preach the word are men who preach Christ crucified throughout the entirety of the scriptures. They're men who can read their Old Testaments and say, let me show you how this points to Jesus and what he has done. What Paul's pointing out here, friends, is that the best way to protect from this heresy that's creeping into the church and to battle against that same heresy is with a bold and accurate proclamation of the truth. Paul is claiming that you should have men in your church, if at all possible, who are devoted to right doctrine being taught in the church on a regular basis. So Paul tells the church, to ensure that's happening, pay such men. This is a good and necessary and worthy work. If you want to make sure that God's word is being upheld in God's church, then ensure that there are godly men who are preaching God's word to God's people, and who are set apart so that they can do that to the best of their ability. And I want to point out two implications that I think come with Paul's idea here of providing for these teachers. And that's first that compensation to these teachers implies the importance of the truth. This implies how important the truth is, the word, how important the word of God is to the church. This little sentence reminds us that the church ought to be under the word of God. See that? It reminds us how important it is for the church to be rooted in the gospel, to be a people who cherish the truth. In fact, we cherish the truth so much that we ought to eagerly give up our money to ensure that the truth is being taught and studied well by a designated person week after week. Remember what Jesus says in Matthew 6, 19 to 21. He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. See, church, when you give up your time, your talents, your money to ensure sure that your pastors are freed up to study and to prepare the gospel week after week, you are tangibly declaring that your treasure is the truth. That you would rather have truth on Sunday mornings than a Lambo to drive on Saturday nights. That you would rather have good preaching than good prophets. That you want the word more than you want anything in the world. And the way that you spend your money expresses that. So the Christian community realizes that we, as Jesus quotes in Matthew 4, do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. We realize how vitally important it is that we are fed the Scriptures. Maybe in practical terms, you could actually say that the Christian should write into their budget not only the food that they need for their physical sustenance, but also the food that they need for their souls. Just like you'd willingly, friends, pay money to a doctor happily to fix physical ailments that you have, you ought to readily give money to ensure that your soul is being cared for. That's what Paul is implying here. But why? Because the truth is important to us. That's why. In fact, if I get up here and I start to defer from the truth or veer from the truth or proclaim anything other than the truth, if I start to preach rank heresy and you're starting to recommend that and you're saying this isn't the word, this isn't the Scriptures, this isn't the truth, then you ought to be saying I'm going to get my money somewhere else. You ought to be saying get this guy out of here and let's get somebody in here who's going to give us the word. See, it's not that you're exalting the man and trying to project something good within the man. It's that you are exalting the word of God that you desperately need for the good of your souls. So if your teachers and preachers are faithfully getting up before you week after week and are feeding you the living word of God, even when it strikes you hard and you don't like it so much, but you know it's true, if your leader's getting up with a humble demeanor saying, I want to show you what God says in his word, then your soul is being fed in that moment something that is vital to you, and you express a need of that by the way that you give good things to the one who is teaching. You are sowing the word of truth in your heart that will reap a harvest of righteousness. Don't you want that? Don't you want that for your soul? Every Christian church ought to desire having that. Every Christian church ought to say, give me the word. Give me as much of the word as I can get. I am hungry. I am needy. I need God's truth. So let's make sure that there's somebody who can study it and know it and teach it accurately. John MacArthur, reading a quote a long time ago that I think captures why a congregation gives to support the ministry of the word financially, and also how every congregation should expect their pastors to handle the word. Church, I'm going to read something here, and I hope that this is the way that you think about what my role ought to be within the church. Please do that, Pastor. That's what we're paying you to do. Listen to this. Fling him into his office. Tear the office sign off the door and nail on the sign, study. Take him off the mailing list. Lock him up with his books and his typewriter and his Bible. Force him to be the one man in our surfeited communities who knows about God. Throw him into the ring to box with God until he learns how short his arms are. Engage him to wrestle with God all the night through and let him come out only when he's bruised and beaten into being a blessing. Shut his mouth from spouting remarks and stop his tongue from tripping lightly over every non-essential. Require him to have something to say before he dares break the silence. Bend his knees in the lonesome valley. Burn his eyes with weary study. Wreck his emotional poise with worry for God. And make him exchange his pious stance for a humble walk with God and man. Make him spend and be spent for the glory of God. Rip out his telephone. Burn up his ecclesiastical success sheets. Give him a Bible and tie him to the pulpit. And make him preach the word of the living God. form a choir to raise a chant and haunt him with it night and day, saying, "Sir, we would see Jesus." When he dares to say the pulpit, ask him if he has a word from God. If he does not, then dismiss him. Tell him you can read the morning paper and digest the television and commentaries and think through the day's superficial problems and manage the community's weary drives and bless the sorted baked potatoes and green beans ad infinitum on your own. Command him not to come back until he's read and reread, written and rewritten, until he can stand up worn and forlorn and say, "Thus saith the Lord." Break him across the board of his ill-gotten popularity. Smack him hard with his own prestige. Corner him with questions about God. Cover him with demands for celestial wisdom and give him no escape until his back is against the wall of the word. And sit down before him and listen to the only word that he has left, God's word. Let him be totally ignorant of the downstreet gossip, but give him a chapter and order him to walk around it, camp on it, sup with it, and come at last to speak it backward and forward until he says about it, what he says about it rings with the truth of eternity. And when he is burned out by the flaming word, when he's consumed at last by the fiery grace blazing through him, and when he's privileged to translate the truth of God to man, finally transferred from earth to heaven, then bear him away gently and blow a muted trumpet and lay him down softly. Place a two-edged sword in his coffin and raise the tomb triumphant, for he was a brave soldier of the word, and ere he died, he had become a man of God. The church needs men who do that. There's nothing special about the man. You aren't compensating someone because they're so unique and so special. You aren't compensating somebody because they have Trinity style and great leadership strength and just a general aura about them that's going to take the church to the next level. Church is not about the man. It's about the word. You see that? It's about the word being rightly preached and proclaimed. Because of the high view of the word that Paul portrays in his teaching, there's also expectations on the man who speaks the word, not just on the congregation that provides for the man. And that's the second implication that I want to point out to you, the importance of teachers laboring in the word. The importance of teachers laboring in the word. Paul is teaching that teachers of the gospel should be paid because they need to devote themselves to doing their job well. Paul told Timothy, who is a pastor and preacher of the word, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. The seminary I went to, Southern Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky, had that phrase carved into the front building in Greek, rightly dividing the word of truth. Friends, you should realize there's nothing more dangerous in all the world than a lazy preacher and teacher of God's word. Christian communities are communities that must take the word of God seriously. Because of that, they should have standards, especially for those who occupy the pulpit on Sunday morning. Man should never get into this pulpit he's not seriously dealt with God. I want to be careful here to not project an impossible standard. Okay, I'm not saying that teachers of the word are expected to be perfect. None of us are. We're all finite creatures. But those who teach the word should remember the words of James 3:1. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that those who teach will be judged with greater strictness. If you are going to teach and preach God's word, then you need to be committed to diving deeply into the text. You need to be a workman who's not ashamed, who rightly handles the word of truth. See, a healthy church is a church that's biblically rooted and theologically informed. And that's what we want our church to be. We want to be a church who takes this seriously. believe that those who are being compensated for the work of ministry ought to be all the more diligent and faithful to preach the gospel well. That's what you're being freed up to do. Guard right doctrine. Minister the word to the people of God. Take it seriously. The compensation that's being given to a pastor is not so that that pastor can freeload and have the easiest job on the planet just riding off of the checks from the church. It's so the gospel can advance without error. So let that be a charge, even to any who make their living by the gospel. Don't waste it. Don't waste it. Be faithful. Be a workman unashamed. Dig as deeply as you can, always and forever, to the words of this text. Know them backward and forward. And as soon as you think you have a handle on it, go back to it to realize just how far you yet have to go. Let that truth transform us from within, which leads to our next call, call two, to sow within. The first call is to sow the word. The second call is to sow within. Look at Galatians 6, verses 7 and 8. Paul writes, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life." In these verses, Paul begins by warning the churches once again, do not be deceived. God will not be played the fool. He will not be mocked. There may be lots of false teachers whose works look really good, and they may be claiming that they have the true gospel, but ultimately they will reap what they sow. And though they appear like they have it all together, in reality before God, they are sowing to the flesh. God will not be mocked. God will not be tricked. God will not be duped. Remember, in Galatians, Paul's warning the churches to not follow these false teachers who are coming in and are adding to the gospel. The false teachers are trying to get the believers to rely on their flesh, rely on themselves for your justification. That's the core issue that's going on in Galatians. Rely on what you can do in order to get yourself to God. A little bit of Jesus, a little bit of you equals what's true. I didn't mean to rhyme that, but it happened. That was their gospel. Jesus plus equals what you need. Paul's telling them that's sowing in the flesh. Because this church needs to lean on Jesus and Jesus alone. You see, the true gospel is that a sinner can only be justified or declared right before God by faith in the substitutionary work of Christ in our place. It's only Jesus who can save us. To rely on anything in addition to Jesus for our salvation is to be one who is sowing to the flesh. So here in these verses, Paul juxtaposes once again the flesh and the spirit. We've seen this over and over again for weeks now. The flesh and the spirit. The one who sows to the flesh, you see, will reap corruption. But the one who sows to the spirit will reap eternal life. Now, I know that many of us may be city folk, and so we probably need a little bit of help with the analogy at this point. Sowing is planting seed. That's what sowing is. Reaping is harvesting the crop. So the idea here is that sowing good seed, cultivating that seed, is going to lead to a bountiful harvest. But then on the other hand, sowing bad seed, or not caring for the crop, is either going to lead to a bad harvest or no harvest at all. Did you know it can actually, even to this day, ruin a farmer if a seed supplier sends him bad seed? Because if you're sowing bad seed, then it doesn't matter how much work and effort you put into it, the field is going to have no hope of producing a crop. It doesn't matter how hard you try. If you're starting with bad seed, you're going to reap something bad, corruption. In fact, I actually, when I was researching some of this, saw a YouTube video in which a guy was showing an example of good seed versus bad seed. He had within this patch of his garden split directly in half seeds that he got from a local supplier, and then he had seeds that he got out of the supermarket $1 packet that he had sown in the same garden. One side, lush, beautiful, growing. The other side, corrupt, horrible, nothing was there. Bad plants. So you can could see tangibly the difference between these two kinds of fields. So the point, friends, is you reap what you sow. The idea that Paul is showing us here is that there are two possible outcomes that are going to be drastically different based on what the person is sowing within themselves. One field is a field of the flesh, over there. And the other field is the field of the spirit. So first, let's look at what it means to sow to the flesh. Sowing to the flesh, friends, is to sow to the self. It's to pander and to coddle and to exalt your flesh rather than do what Paul says in verse 24, to crucify it. It's when you don't take your sin seriously. You begin to think of it as being more like a harmless teddy bear instead of the 1,000-pound gorilla that's rogue and vicious and will kill you with one swipe of its hand. For some, that means that the way that the false teachers were encouraging the Galatians to go is the way that you might want to go. You may sow to the flesh by thinking and believing and convincing yourself that God's favor toward you is dependent upon your own performance in religious matters. You are looking to yourself and how good you are doing with your religious activity as your confidence before God. That's sowing to the flesh. Looking to yourself instead of to Christ. You do all of the good religious things, but it isn't out of a joyful dependence upon the Spirit. Instead, it's out of an overwhelming sense of guilt, an obligation, and duty. Your church attendance, and all of your service, and all the rest that you do, they don't proceed from faith that works within you, they proceed from fear. That's sowing to the flesh. Self-preservation, self-exaltation. But Paul, no doubt, has all the works of the flesh that he lists in Galatians 5, 19 to 21 also in mind here. And I think John Stott comments helpfully on this. Listen to what he writes. The seeds we sow are largely thoughts and deeds. Every time we allow our mind to harbor a grudge, nurse a grievance, entertain an impure fantasy, or wallow in self-pity, we are sowing to the flesh. Every time we linger in bad company whose insidious influence we know we cannot resist, every time we lie in bed when we ought to be up praying, every time we read pornographic literature, every time we take a risk which strains our self-control, we are sowing to the flesh. Some Christians sow to the flesh every day and wonder why they don't reap holiness. Holiness is a harvest. Whether we reap it or not depends almost entirely on what we sow. We were here a couple weeks ago. Remember we talked about self-control as the final attribute of the Holy Spirit working its fruit within us. And we considered at length the importance of applying the means of grace that God has provided toward killing sexual sin in our lives. And I wonder, have you continued sowing to the flesh? Even since then, have you resisted deleting the app that you know you ought to delete? Have you considered the danger that comes when you don't take the radical measures that need to be taken to kill your sin? Are you sowing to the flesh? Have you backed off from your commitment to confess your sins to people that you know you should confess them to? Are you sowing to the flesh? So these are the ways that we continue to sow to the flesh, sowing to the flesh. And Paul tells us that kind of sowing reaps corruption. That word corruption there means destruction. It means perishing. It means utter moral decay. So when you sow to the flesh, you won't end up with a field bustling with life, friends. Instead, you'll end up with a field that's more like the potter's field where Judas was buried after he betrayed Jesus and then killed himself. That was a field where they would throw the bodies of people who nobody cared about and leave them to rot. That's a field. corruption. And that's what sowing the flesh will lead your soul to. Sowing the Spirit, on the other hand, will lead to life and peace. You see, if you are in Christ, remember that's who Paul's writing to, people that have believed the gospel, then you need to remember that God has united you to Christ by faith. You need to remember that you have been objectively forgiven of all your sins, that God himself has declared you righteous by crediting the righteousness of Jesus to your account, so there's no more condemnation for you, no more fear of judgment. He put his Holy Spirit in you to end the reign of death in you and to begin the reign of life in him. So you have that life set up within your soul. We need to continue to walk by the Spirit that's brought life to us. Or, as it's put here, we must sow to the Spirit. Let's consider what that means, sowing to the Spirit. In Romans 8:6, Paul writes, "For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace." I believe that sowing to the Spirit, friends, is setting our minds on the things of the Spirit. You see, that's why it's so important, as Paul says just above, to compensate preachers who preach the Word, because the things of the Spirit are bound up in the book that hopefully is sitting in your lap right now. The Bible was written by the Holy Spirit. So you may remember Jesus said to his apostles in John 14:26, "These things I've spoken to you while I'm still with you." But listen to this. "The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." So the Holy Spirit comes, and he enlightens the eyes of the hearts of these apostles, and he empowers them to preach and teach the Scriptures through a Christ-centric lens. And it's by the preaching of the cross that in the early church, thousands upon thousands are saved. And their apostolic doctrines then were written down for us in what Paul calls God-breathed Scripture. Everything in this book, yes, was written by man, but ultimately those men were being carried along by the Holy Spirit of God, such that it was more truly written by the Holy Spirit through the vessel of man. You have the words of God before you right now, church. So to walk by the Spirit then is to fill yourself with the truth that the Spirit has provided you. This is the word of Christ. It's the word of the living God, a living word, as the author of Hebrews writes. So we sow to the Spirit when we go to the truth that the Spirit has provided for us and allow it to do the work that it's supposed to do on us. Some of you may have seen me post about this just a couple weeks ago on Facebook, but a week or so ago, I was finally getting to unpack books in my study. While I was doing that, I found the Bible that I had sitting in my lap the night that the Holy Spirit indwelled me and brought life to my soul for the first time. It was summer before my sophomore year in high school. And that was also the Bible that I had for the first couple of years of my true walk with the Lord. And I just, when I found this, sat up on the floor of my study looking through this torn and tattered Bible, weeping. Because as I did, memories rushed back as I flipped through those pages, and I saw all these little markings and notes that teenage Brendan had made. And the reason it was such a powerful and joyful memory for me is because the change that the Holy Spirit did in my life when he dwelled me didn't just occur all at once that night when I first heard the gospel of Christ crucified and believed. The big change actually occurred as the Holy Spirit within me led me to the pages of Scripture and began to teach me and transform me through the very words that were there. This word of the living God began to tear through my soul, change me from the inside out. And here is the thing that you need to remember, church. Every true Christian can say that. Every true Christian can say, "God's word has done that to me too. God's word has torn." Christians won't even be able to recognize the difference between when the Word meant nothing to them and God's Spirit indwelled them and the Word suddenly became everything to them. Not every Christian can remember that exact moment of what we call regeneration, but the Spirit-filled Christian can say with certainty that the Word of God still is living, that it still continues to target us, so to speak, that it still continues to speak to us and to grow us in the manner that God has ordained to this day. And so if you want to sow to the Spirit, then set your mind on things of the Spirit. Immerse yourself in this truth. And not just in your private study, by the way, but perhaps even more importantly, alongside of the church. You got to remember the corporate nature of all of this. Paul is writing to churches. He's saying, church, you need to come together and compensate the teacher of the word together so that you can sit under the word together. And then look at the good news. Sowing to the Spirit reaps what? Now let's be clear. Paul is not saying that you're justified before God by sowing to the Spirit. You know what he's saying? If he was saying that, then he'd be contradicting everything that he said in the letter before, and we know Paul was not a guy who would contradict himself, especially by the power of the Holy Spirit. What Paul's doing, he's making the point to Christians who've been filled with the Spirit of life, that they now have life in God. But we're not given the Spirit so that we can just lounge and kick back and not have a care in the world, friends. We're given the Spirit so that we can work cultivating and taking dominion over God's garden for His glory. You remember that Adam was placed in the Garden of Eden, which was overflowing with abundant life. I mean, just think about that garden imagery within the garden, overflowing with life. Green everywhere, fruit everywhere, vegetables everywhere, but Adam wasn't told, go on and sit and just enjoy the feast all the time. He was told, work the garden and keep it. In the same way, friends, God puts life in your soul, but then He calls you to work it and to cultivate it and to make it grow. It's all by His power. You're not going to grow if His power is not at work in you, but that's why He puts His Spirit in you. So that you now have the ability to grow in godliness by sowing to the Spirit. And when you sow to the Spirit, what you will find is that you will have greater and greater measures of the experience of life in God. You'll know God more. You'll love God more. You'll see the fruit of the Spirit abounding in your life more and more because you are sowing to the Spirit and not to the flesh. Your life is going to be one that's active. Vigorous, that's devoted to God, that's blessed and absolutely filled with the fullness of God. And such sowing within the church will produce a sowing without. So call three that we see in this text is to sow without, outside of ourselves. Look at Galatians 9 and 10, Galatians 6, 9 and 10. Paul writes, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Some of y'all need to hear that, isn't it? You're close to giving up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good. Especially to those who are of the household of faith. These verses are incredibly encouraging words to the end. Any Christians in here feeling weary this morning? Any Christians in here feeling a little bit weak this morning? The word weary there means to be utterly needs to be spiritually exhausted. I think Paul's mind here is especially drawn towards those who are exhausted by their doing good within the church. They are serving God's church. They are toiling to care for the needs of the church, and they are plumb worn out from all of it. I think Paul has in mind primarily church work because of what we see in verse 10. You see there in verse 10, he says, "Let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith." The household of faith are the people of God. That is the church. So apparently, these Christians were deeply invested into the church such that they were tempted to grow weary in their service to the church. Now, I just want to make a couple important observations here. First is this: don't miss the centrality and importance of the church. The Bible makes this clear again and again and again that our Christian lives are not to be lived out in isolation. They're supposed to be lived out in community. They're not just supposed to be lived out with the members of your own household, even if they're Christians. They're supposed to be lived out serving the household of God. In fact, you should be so focused on serving the church that there could be times when you're tempted to grow weary from your service to the church, because that's how deeply you're invested into the life of the body. I just wonder, are you invested to that degree? Have you ever been to the point where you've been tempted to grow weary from serving the church and doing so much good that you're at the point of utter exhaustion? Primarily who Paul has in mind here. The people like that. The people who are busy with the work of the kingdom. And it's led them to a place of absolute weariness. But secondly, we also see here that Paul commands Christians to do good to everyone. He says to everyone. Yes, especially to the household of faith, but to everyone. That means we don't only do good to our Christian brothers and sisters, so that's the priority. We do good to everyone. So the Christian life then ought to be filled, church, with good works and hard labor for the kingdom of God. God didn't save us for nothing. He saves us for something. And that something is to walk in the good works that he has prepared beforehand for us as we are made new in him. Look at Ephesians 2, verse 10 for that. But we need to be clear here that we do not do works and serve to gain a righteous standard before him, or standing before him. We work because we've gained a righteousness in him. He's planted his spirit in us, transformed us by the power of the gospel, and has given us then the power and the will and the desire to serve him and his kingdom. Not to gain righteousness, but because of the righteousness that we've gained. Listen to how Martin Luther puts this in commenting on this passage. "When I have this righteousness within me, I descend from heaven like the rain that makes the earth fertile." That's the righteousness of Christ. The righteousness of Christ in me is like I descend from heaven like the rain that makes the earth fertile. That is, I come forth into another kingdom, and I perform good works whenever the opportunity arises. And if I am a minister of the word, I preach. I comfort the saddened. I administer the sacraments. If I am a father, I rule my household and family. I train my children in piety and honesty. If I am a magistrate, I perform the office I've received by divine command. If I am a servant, I faithfully tend to my master's affairs. In short, whoever knows for sure that Christ is his righteousness, not only cheerfully and gladly works in his calling, but also submits himself for the sake of love to magistrates, also to the wicked laws, and to everything else in this present life, even if need be, to burden and danger. For he knows that God wants this and that his obedience pleases him. Church, a people who grasp the glory of God on display through the work that he has done for us and the finished work of Christ, that's a church that is going to be filled with joy and life in God. People who have a spring in their step, so to speak, who are saying, "I want to advance God's kingdom, not out of obligation and duty, but out of joy. Just like Jesus, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, Christ in me has changed me to the extent that the joy that is within me wants to see good advance all over the face of this world. To the point that I might even get weary at times. So Paul gives us a command. Don't grow weary in doing good. But I want to leave you this morning with the glorious promise that's attached to that command. You see it there? It's a promise of hope. He says, do not grow weary in doing good because a due season of reaping is coming. What keeps the farmer going in the spring, in the heat of summer when the skin is scorched, working outside, laboring and sweating under the back-breaking work, what keeps him going is knowing that the harvest is coming. The harvest is coming. And here you have Paul reminding the weary Christian, do not give up. Remember what's coming. The work is worthy because a due season is coming. And the blessing of that due season may be experienced partially in this life, confident that it will be experienced fully when we're at home. So keep your eyes fixed, church, on that due season. You know what due season means in the Greek? It means an appointed time. In other words, there is a sovereign God who reigns in the heavens, who has appointed the time that the harvest will come. He is going to ensure that it happens. He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion. So keep your head down and keep on working. Keep plowing. Keep sowing. Keep applying all the weed control and fertilizer that needs to be applied to your life. Don't give up. Don't give up on your wayward child who needs your prayers and your love. Don't give up on your church, even if the fellowship is sometimes difficult. Don't give up on your neighbors who seem to reject or ignore the gospel no matter how many times you present it to them. Don't give up on your marriage when you find yourself in the muck of difficult conflicts and disagreements. Don't give up on your parenting when the discipline feels endless and you feel like you're never making any progress. Don't give up, friends, on the ministry that God has called you to when you've been sowing and sowing and sowing and sowing gospel seeds for years and it seems like there is nothing to show for it. There is a due season coming, church. It is coming. God has not lost control. The harvest is coming. So sow to the Spirit. Press into an ever greater dependence upon your God. Unceasingly sow the word of God into your soul. And remember that everything that God has done for you in Christ Jesus is sufficient for all of you. Father, we thank you for passages like this that you put in your word for our good, knowing that there's going to be seasons when we may be tempted to give up. And Lord, I do pray that whatever truth is from you would fall upon the ears of whoever would hear, that would sink into their hearts and give them hope that can come from you. Lord, I pray that our church would be a church that, even as we've put in our little vision statement, that really does have the good of the city in mind. That does good. That comes from you, not from trying to puff ourselves up in self-righteousness, but that comes from an overflow of the love of God at work in us. Lord, would you do that in us? And I pray, Lord, that we would remember what we need more than anything for strengthening is your word. It's your gospel. this table before us that we're about to partake in, to remember that Christ has done everything for us, for the redemption that we need from sin. So I pray that our joy would be found in Him, our peace would be found in Him, our rest would be found in Him, and as we are overwhelmed by the love that You have for us that's been displayed in us.